Rishi Swarup is here, Dr. Sri Ganesh, Ashish Nagpal, Vardhaman, Dr. Cyrus Mehta, Dr. Bharti, Dr. Ritika. All the participants who are presenting are here. Dr. G.S. Dhami, Dr. Natasha, Dr. Krishna Prasad Kudlu is here. So we have all our panelists here, I think. And our first case situation is myope, minus 2.5 diopter spheres, lady, 25 years old, central corneal thickness 475. So we will be having five presenters. Dr. Vardhaman is going to kick it off by saying that for this myope of 2.5 diopters, no astigmatism, corneal thickness 475, he has to defend why he's going to do SMILE. This will be followed by Dr. Rishi Swarup, who is going to defend why he would do SURFACE for this patient. Shreyas Ramamurthy is going to speak on why he would do phakic lens for this patient. Dr. Kumar Doctor will be trying to defend why he would do LASIK for this patient. And then to sum it up, I think we have Dr. Jagat Ram sir, who is going to say that why he would not like to touch this patient. So we have five ways to handle a minus 2.5 sphere with a corneal thickness of 475. Topography is normal. So I think we can go ahead and Vardhaman can start and then Rishi will take over here.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Gaurav. As we know, this is a patient who has a relatively thinner cornea. It is 275 microns and about minus 2.5 diopters that we have to take care. And let's say that the ablation will be in the zone of, let's say, 40 to 50 microns, so will be the lenticule as well. Typically, for all the patients, my first choice is always SMILE over all the eczema laser-based procedures. SMILE has advantage over LASIK and PRK, over LASIK because there is no flap to get displaced and there is less dry eye, better maintenance of corneal biomechanics, and over PRK because there is no pain, no regression, faster visual recovery, and a relatively better wow effect. As per the eczema laser based procedures, the SMILE has better centration because the centration is on visual axis, less induction of aberrations, and no influence of surrounding atmosphere. But in this particular case, because we are talking about slightly thinner corneas, although it is not extremely thin cornea, it is 475 microns, so it is a relatively thinner cornea. So I guess all three approaches, including PRK, LASIK, as well as SMILE, can potentially be done for this low myope. My first choice will always be SMILE, as I have discussed before, but especially in this case, because we are dealing with low corneal thickness, the SMILE has better maintenance of corneal biomechanical strength. As we can see from Reinstein et al., that the anterior stroma gives much higher biomechanical strength as compared to the posterior stroma, and in SMILE we are actually able to conserve as much as anterior lamellae as possible as compared to LASIK as well as in PRK. In fact, the mathematical model, which was also published by Reinstein et al., has shown that the relative tensile strength of cornea after SMILE is better than not only LASIK, but is probably also better than PRK. So for all these reasons, I would like to go for SMILE, which takes the advantage of both PRK and LASIK together for this particular patient. Thank you very much for your kind attention. Thank you.
Kumar?
Speakers are requested not to take extra time than allotted to them, otherwise the whole purpose of this is getting lost.
Swarup, kya hua?
Your time has already started.
What should I do?
No, it's not.
He'll be talking on the same topic.
Okay, my slides, please. Vardhaman tried to convince us to spend three times the amount of money that you can do equally good result. So my stand is that you should do a surface ablation. It's a straightforward case. It's a low refractive error, just 2.75 diopters, no cylinder. Low chance of haze, even if you don't use mitomycin C, very, very minimal chance of haze. There's adequate residual stroma, so you don't have to worry about post-LASIK ectasia. Tectonically, we know that surface ablation is the strongest, whatever anybody may say. SMILE cannot come close. It's the least invasive procedure. You're not cutting anything. It's all laser. Endothelium friendly. Safety first. So it's the safest procedure out of all the refractive procedures. In a Hippocratic oath, we said first do no harm. So that's why I would do a surface ablation.
Who's the next speaker? Kumar? Shreyas?
So as my presentation is coming up, what my fellow mates here forgot to mention here is, it's a 470 micron cornea, 2.5 diopter spherical error. No, they took the liberty of saying normal tomography or normal topography. It's not mentioned it's normal topography. Neither do we know anything about the stability of the refractive error of the patient, the age profile of the patient. Now, there are so many of these factors that we have to worry about when you have a refractive error, when you have a thin cornea, all these issues. So why worry about any of these things? As long as the patient is above 18 or 20 years of age and with stable refraction, why not go ahead with a phakic lens whatsoever, irrespective of the topography of the pachymetry? Can I have my slides, please?
Audiovisual, what is the problem?
90 seconds. Ah. I think they're overwhelmed by the number of speakers and for the time.
Baba, if you give connection there, it's very easy. The cables, if you are connected on the podium, no? We could have connected ourselves.
So I'll only request that all the speakers do give in their presentations in case they haven't, those who haven't loaded. Huh? But still, yes, sir.
So I've
Gaurav, have, what is the problem?
Already
Kumar, kya hai problem aapko?
If Kumar is ready, we can have Kumar speaking first and then Shreyas will continue.
Yeah. Presentation is ready, madam. They just have to bring it on the screen.
But you wait here only. Sir, आप आगे पीछे देख के कोइंबटोर के बारे में कुछ बोलिए।
So for the team, team who's managing the voting,
yes.
So I think Kumar, can we have the other speaker next?
Kumar, you can continue.
No.
Even Dr. Jagat Ram is
ready. Has to be plugged there.
Jagat.
There's no provision here.
Jagat, is yours ready?
Kumar. You are always loaded, Dr. Maskari.
So for the team who's managing the voting pads, who's heading the team who's managing the voting pads?
Gaurav, shall we have some discussion?
Yeah, I think
because see, it makes no sense. We are wasting time.
I know we are wasting time.
Okay. That's what I'm saying. Let's give it
yeah,
an example, Gaurav.
Let there
please.
Be no slides.
We don't need slides.
The slides are here. Shreyas, you can come. Your slides are here.
Exactly.
Shreyas, your slides are here.
Shreyas. Okay, you have come on stage.
Okay, whoever slides don't work, don't bother about it. You can just speak without a slide. It's all
yes,
right.
Yes, ma'am. I'll. So like I said earlier, we have a myope here of -2.5 with a CCT of 470. No idea about topography and stability and age of the patient. So do we really have to worry about all these things when you're doing phakic IOL versus keratoablative surgery? Be it low myopia, moderate, high myopia, compound myopic astigmatism, it has been proven beyond doubt, both in Cochrane reviews as well as in multiple other studies, that in all refractive outcomes, safety, efficacy, predictability, stability, you name it, phakic IOL clearly scores over any platform of wavefront guided treatment or wavefront optimized treatment. What better can you have than phakic IOL, a natural lens placed inside the eye with better quality of vision? with a lower powered phakic IOL, you can have an optic effective optic zone at the corneal plane of 7.5 millimeters, which is just impossible with any other refractive platform for such a thin cornea. Fewer higher order aberrations are induced, there is better contrast sensitivity, there is no quality, there is no question that there is better quality of vision. And most importantly, when you're doing a laser correction in a thin cornea, you're worried about regression, you're worried about ectasia in any keratoablative surgery, there's absolutely no risk of that with a phakic IOL. And with a centroflow lens, there's absolutely almost no incidence of cataract being reported nowadays. And with minimal investment, you don't need these expensive gadgets, you don't need a femto laser, you don't need an excimer laser, just go ahead with your regular instruments and implant a phakic IOL. I don't really think there is any debate in this question whatsoever that be it low myopia or high myopia, phakic IOL is the future. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, Shreyas. What about Kumar? What's your opinion on?
See, I have to talk for something that I don't want to do, but I'll talk.
Yes, talk. You say you don't want to do it.
No, don't want to do. 470 cornea.
Huh?
And they want me to do LASIK.
Then
okay, do so femto LASIK now.
Why are you talking on it?
Medical legal.
Okay, quickly get my computer. No, I gave the connector.
No, but why? They should not keep on changing it. No, you use the same connector.
My computer. So the biggest advantage is customizing flaps. This, nothing can be done anywhere else. So we have all the different systems here. So I'm just going, because we have 90 seconds, what I'm going to show you is different side cuts. So if you have a 470 cornea and a 2 diopter, there's no dispute that when you can customize your side cut, you get phenomenal security. So if you have a 150 degree side cut, you are actually entrapping the cornea, the flap itself. So this is a 70 degree side cut. So I'll just show you a 70 degree side cut just on high magnification. This is how it looks. And now I'm going to show you about 150 degree side cut. So watch this. Once the flap is made, you are actually everting the edge of the flap. So if you have a thinner cornea and we want to do LASIK, no doubt that LASIK is extremely proven, safe procedure with phenomenal nomograms for so many years of practice. This is a 150 degree side cut. I'm everting the edge. You do the laser and put the flap in and tuck the flap in, so when the IOP rises, actually you're sealing the cut. So the question of anything else happening here is not possible, and that's the reason why I feel that LASIK is quite a safe procedure for this patient. We'll have excellent results. So you can see that I put the flap in, tuck the flap in, cover the tuck, it's a 150 degree side cut, the IOP rises, it self seals, and this is better for the patient for the future. Thank you.
Thanks, Jagat. Kumar. We'll request Dr. Jagat Ram, sir, to please come with his the final verdict. He wants to defend. Sir is going to defend not doing anything, best left alone. Myope minus 2.5, corneal thickness 475.
Time should be 90 seconds.
90 seconds, please. Can you set the timer to 90 seconds and start the time? Can you reset the timer to 90 seconds? Yeah.
Okay, Dr. Rupal, this is a patient myopia minus 2.5 diopter, 475 micron, central corneal thickness. Whatever other people have said, I don't agree with that. It has to be left alone. Why? What is the concept of risk? Not an all or none concept does not determine who will or will not develop ectasia. Based on the stringent scientific analysis, determine what group of the people present higher chance of the event such as ectasia. This is a study in ophthalmology which shows that if the corneal thickness is less than 500 micron and residual bed thickness is less than 250 micron, yes, surely there is a risk of ectasia. Is there any magic number to reduce the risk of ectasia? And this is the illustrative example where corneal thickness is 535 and myopia is minus 1.75 diopter. And this was a case of keratoconus. So in this our patient, there are missing preoperative data which shows which is equally important to make the decision. Corneal topography or pentacam and keratometry is not available. Which technique to be used, whether to use femtosecond or PRK, that is not known. Corneal biomechanics is not known. And whether female patient pregnancy is there or not, that is not known. If these factors are not known, then I will like to leave it alone.
Thank you, sir, for your nice inputs. So we have 5 minutes for discussion now on this case itself. So Dr. Rupal, would you like to take the lead?
Yeah, sure. I would like to start with Vardhman. Vardhman, I agree with most of the things that you said. So we'll come to you at the end. But the next person who spoke was Dr. Swaroop. Dr. Swaroop, where is he? He's left. Because I wanted to ask him how he came from Hyderabad to here. And I'm sure he must have taken a flight while he could come easily in a train, not spending much money, just spending more time. So PRK or SMILE, there is no debate here. It has to be better to do SMILE. As regards LASIK, of course, Kumar himself is not much convinced, so that goes out of question. As regards ICL, Shreyas, ICL costs how much to the patient? Yes. How much do you charge to the patient?
Right. You're charging 60,000 to the patient?
Per eye, right? Is it? So, you know, and just as you don't know enough about the cornea in this particular case, you also don't know enough about the anterior chamber depth. So you cannot just decide whether to do ICL in this case. And in case you are suspecting that cornea to be having a chance of going into ectasia, you would still not want to do an ICL, because after ICL also the cornea is still going to remain ectatic if it is going to become ectatic. So you would have a change later on, and then you don't want to have any procedures done at that time. That gets us to, of course, Dr. Jagatram, who is playing it absolutely safe by not touching that patient at all. But sir, the patient has come for a procedure.
Yeah,
patient. So you have to try and find the procedure which is going to work and which is also going to be safe.
Yeah, so actually, what is the difference of opinion is these people, none of these people asked keratometry, none of these people pentacam, none of these people whether person has pregnancy, they have not provided any support.
Sir,
so I don't agree with them. Totally,
sir,
I don't agree with them.
If they ask these many questions, then 90 seconds will get over in that. It's assumed that all that is normal, and then we are proceeding to this. No, you can't mention everything possible there. And when the patient comes to you also, after examining everything, you still don't have all the information about the patient and you still operate on them. So if you want to be practical, what you have to find is the procedure which would be working well in and giving the least.
So what I feel is Vardhaman was able to bribe Dr. Rupal, you know, on the panel, and you know, Dr. Vardhaman did a good job of bribing Dr. Rupal that, you know, she wants to propagate. She's
yes,
debating for SMILE as well. All the same, we would like to have a vote. Okay, yes, Kumar.
Every person should declare financial interest.
Anyway, so
but
so,
one know, thing I just want
Dr.
to say
Amar,
something
yes,
before the
yes.
voting comes. I think everybody has got a very valid point. I think Jagat, to be honest, has got a very valid point. I think PRK is definitely not a bad alternative when you don't have SMILE. SMILE definitely is a great technique. And I'll tell you frankly, ICL is a great technique even with low powers of -2.75. As Shreya said very correctly, if the anterior chamber depth is good, which was not mentioned here, that is fair enough. He didn't know the answer, but let's take it's normal. I think they're good. LASIK is, as Kumar himself personally directly said before, perhaps might be the one weak link, because the advantage in SMILE is you can go in the thinner corneas. But all of them are pretty good alternatives. So to be honest to you, and she's the queen, obviously, of the whole story here. So she's sitting next to me and is the queen. And I think she was a pioneer who's in SMILE and showed all of us and the world what SMILE is. And for that, I tell you, salute. So let's work for the voting. Gaurav, can we go ahead?
Okay, so we
have an audience poll.
Okay. Do you have keypad here? Has,
everybody in the audience has. If those who don't have can raise their hands, the team can give it to them. Those who don't have voting pads can please raise their hands. Can you please distribute the... Yeah, he's doing that right now. So we have five options and we would like to ask the audience whom they would like to go with. Would they like to go with Professor Jagat Ram sir, who has said that... So choice number one. So remember, if you press one, it is going to be for best left alone, that's Dr. Jagat Ram. If you press two, it will be for smile, that's for Dr. Vardhaman. If you press three, it will be going with surface, what Dr. Rishi Swarup was trying to tell us. Fakic lens, if you press four, it will go with Dr. Shreyas. And no, that's because the order of presentations was different. So I'm just trying to tell. And number five is, if you press five, then it will be for Dr. Kumar for LASIK. So number one, best left alone, two smile, three surface, four fakic lens, and number five, LASIK. And how much time will we get for the voting? 15 seconds. Can we start? When we start? When we say now, then you can start voting. You have to press it only once. And after pressing one, then do they press anything else? So your vote will be registered the moment you press your choice.
Gaurav,
yes.
Why are we not allowed to vote?
You are allowed to vote, of course. Can we give voting pads to the judges as well? Okay. So can we give voting pads to our judges as well? They want to be part of the thing. Great. So I don't have a voting pad either, so that's okay. So can we start the vote now? Will it show up on the screen that when the voting starts? Please do that. Okay. Yes, please start. Okay, so we have 15 seconds. Please push your number, whatever you think is the right choice. One is for best left alone. You can see the order there. One on top and five at the bottom. So let's see who was able to convince our audience as to what they would like to do. Okay, so we have C as the best choice. And I think surface is what everybody would go with, and I think it's a very fair choice. Wonderful.
But see, so the point, Gaurav, is A. Please, all of you, watch A, what Jagat said. I think it makes a lot of sense. Please. And so, many have voted for A.
I agree completely, and I think what Dr. Jagat Ram said made a lot of sense, that you have to qualify. Whenever you're looking at a case, it should not be a superficial look that this patient is minus 2.5, and you know, be very clear about the topography, whether the corneal thickness is. You can put patients on follow-up for 6 months, 1 year, and you know, watch the patient if they're losing corneal thickness or the topography starts becoming suspicious. Don't jump and treat them right away. And so you could leave them alone for a time and maybe forever. That's a good choice.
One thing which is there among the audience here, with minus 2 or minus 2.5 in your eye, with 470 cornea, how many of you would have gone for surgery and how many would have you left alone, your own eye? Everybody would have left it alone, exactly. You know, with okay, minus so 2 is a good power to have.
Gaurav,
it's a good power to have,
frankly. From next scenario onwards, you should mention these extra things.
I actually did that.
Next one.
I did that, even for the first one. So our next scenario is, can you go to the previous slide, because that, you know, is the situation is there. Yes. So Dr. Sheetal Barar has been nicely and kindly replaced by Dr. Sudarshan. I made the changes, but somehow they don't reflect. So Dr. Sudarshan Kokar will be the first speaker. He will be speaking on smile. The patient is a minus 10 myope with a healthy topography, a corneal thickness of 560, a male patient, 25 years old. Oh, my screen is also gone. Anyway, so we have Dr. Kokar, who is going to defend smile for this patient.
Should I start? Right, thank you. So minus 10 with 560, it's not a bad proposition. You got a good cornea. It's very rare to get 560 corneas in our setup. But if you have 560, you can do all the three options. Okay, so what are the problems? Fakic lenses, sizing is a problem. You want to buy a ready-made shirt, you just got four sizes available. So you have to fit into that. It fits tight on the shoulder. Nobody's bothered. So you have just got four sizes. I don't think that's the way to go. Okay, the vaulting surprises, you can have cataract, you can have glaucoma formation in this one. So eventually they have to be removed from the eye, sooner or later. Okay, so residual thickness in cornea, if you do a LASIK, it works fine because most of the machine will cut about 12 microns per diopter. So you've got a safe zone, so you can do it. But why you don't want to do is because of dry eye and weakening of the cornea. So if you notice here, with a smile, you get a better biomechanics, less damage to the nerves, so there are less chances of dry eye. There's no need to change stations if you have two machines going from one to another. And there are lots of papers to support the corneal nerves and dry eye, which I'm not going. So this is the final slide. So if you notice here, more dry eye with the LASIK, more glare halos there. Flap-related complications, whatever you say, are still there. The two platforms that are required. So smile is a better corneal stability. less dry eye, fewer higher order abrasions induced, no flap related complication. And as we said, phakic lenses are the costliest among the slot if the money is not the problem. And the other end, it has a limited size, which I told you, so I'll stick to the Smile platform for this. Thank you. The next one can come up before.
So can we have the next speaker for this, Dr. Gitansha? Okay, can we have the next speaker if they have the program ready? Harshul, are you ready? And I'll request the rest of the speakers to also, okay. So after this case then? I'll just check if you can do it. Okay.
Cannot refuse General Secretary, sir.
Of course. So Dr. Harshul Tuck is going to speak on phakic lens for this situation. Myope minus 10, corneal thickness 560. And I'll request the other speakers as well if they can just give in their presentations so that while their turn comes, it should not be a problem. I know there's a bit of a chaos there, but.
Yes. Okay, so now we have a situation that patient has minus 10 diopter of myopia. I'll say we can't do LASIK in this patient because the quality of vision is going to be very poor if we treat minus 10 diopter of myopia. Patient is going to have very, very higher amount of higher order aberrations. He's going to have problem in the night vision, glare, halos, and the contrast sensitivity will be very low. There are high chances of regression post LASIK ectasia. And more importantly, it's not approved by FDA to treat more than minus 8 or minus 9. And there are, of course, high chances of dry eyes. And of course, flap-related complications are there. In surface ablation, there are high chances of haze. We all know there, of course, will be poor quality of vision, increased higher order aberrations, regression, ectasia. And moreover, surface ablation is not approved by FDA. Smile has also same problem because of poor quality of vision, regression, and ectasia. ICL is the only answer in this situation as it gives the highest quality of vision in patients with minus 10 diopter myopia. There are no chances of corneal ectasia, no chances of dry eyes. It's a reversible procedure. So I think there is no debate in this case with minus 10 diopter. We all know if we have minus 10 diopter myopia, we'll never go for any these kind of corneal procedures like LASIK or surface ablation or SMILE. Thank you very much.
Nice job, Harshul. Thanks. Gitansha, can you come? Yeah. And Kavita, are you ready? You can come and take the next podium as well. So Dr. Gitansha is going to defend surface ablation in this patient of minus 10. She's kindly agreed to fill in, actually, because it's a tough one. Please go ahead.
Good afternoon. The topic up for debate is whether I would do a surface ablation for a minus 10 diopter sphere in a 560 micron cornea. Well, the answer is yes. When you look at a recent Cochrane review which compares the results of PRK versus LASIK in high myopes of more than 8, the predictability, the risk of regression, and the safety was the same in both cohorts. But when you compare it with the other keratoablative options, in this case, when we do a LASIK, the percentage of tissue altered would exceed 40, which is a risk factor for ectasia. In SMILE, though it might be biomechanically superior, the residual stromal bed in this case would be lower than the significant guidelines. Again, this is a flapless approach. We won't get flap-associated complications. And especially in deep ablations such as this, where the contour gets altered to a great extent, the risk of macrostriae and lacquer cracks remains. So the next concern would be, would using mitomycin C for a longer duration have any side effects? Well, the answer is no, because a 5-year follow-up of mitomycin for over 2 minutes has shown no subclinical corneal changes on confocal. Another Cochrane review to compare PRK with phakic IOLs shows that the uncorrected visual acuity was similar in both cohorts, but phakic IOLs come with their risks of IOL rotation, cataract, retinal detachment, and glaucoma, all of which are visually threatening conditions. So in summary, even though the efficacy and predictability is similar to other procedures, biomechanically it is superior to other keratoablative approaches, and it is safer than implanting something within the eye. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thanks, Gitanshu. Dr. Kavita is going to defend LASIK for this minus 10 patient with a good corneal thickness.
Yeah, good afternoon. Thanks, Gaurav. I would definitely do LASIK in this patient, and why?
Can we have the mic louder, please? Yes.
I would definitely do LASIK in this patient, and why? PTA is definitely within normal range. It is actually 38%. The quality of vision is going to be superior. There is more comfort after surgery, no pain, faster recovery. It is an extraocular surgery and definitely no complication. Now, why not PRK? I think this one slide speaks for itself. This was a high myope in which PRK was done. Look at the haze, and this did not resolve for, I think, around 3 years post the surgery. Why not phakic lens, cataract? The earlier speakers have alluded to this, and being in a retina center, I've seen far more retinal detachments after phakic IOLs, which has does not make that my primary choice of surgery. Now, why SMILE? The SMILE advocates have been talking about it because it's a smaller cut, less dry eye, no flap-related complications, etc. You can see that there are complications intraoperative in SMILE also, definitely maybe in the earlier learning curve. Complications have been reported, epithelial ingrowth, DLK post-SMILE. There is no conclusive results showing that the ectasia is lesser. There are reports of ectasia reported after SMILE as well. Quality of vision, there are many reports which show that there are higher order abrasions which are more in SMILE. There's more backscatter seen on the confocal, and the quality of vision may be superior in LASIK. There is a paper which is recently published which shows that LASIK, the vision and predictability is far superior. So if you don't want your post-op patient reading like this, you stick to LASIK. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Kavita. So I think all our speakers have presented their points well. Dr. Amar, would you like to have the panel answer a few questions or discuss?
So let's ask Krishna Prasad, what would you go for, minus 10? Quick, one answer. Smile only. Namrata? Minus 10. Fake IOL. Yeah, I think, let's be very honest, SMILE is a good alternative. Surface has definitely got its own problems, LASIK. Again, people might say phakic lens is also a good alternative with minus 10. So, panel is open, all are good alternatives. Let's see the voting.
We can have the vote, yes.
Okay.
Can we have the vote, please?
So, when the timer starts, let me know. Yes. It started, okay, all of you, what? 10 seconds left.
Number one, SMILE. Number two, Surface. Number three, phakic lens. Number four, LASIK.
So we have SMILE, Surface Ablation, phakic lens, LASIK. So what are we going for? Phakic lens. Most are going for it. And that I think is a pretty good answer, because with minus 10, remember one thing, phakic lens is a very, very good alternative. SMILE is no doubt very good. So, but I think phakic lens is a very good. Let's move to the next.
Yes, so we'll invite our next speakers.
Namrata?
Our next speakers are going to be Dr. Ashish Nagpal, Dr. Sri Ganesh, Dr. Thind, and Dr. Cyrus. So please load up your presentations. It's worth noticing, sir, that... I told them that they're saying that wo pura na poll ke hisab se laga hua hai, so they can't do it. Yours is number 4 or what? I tried to get it changed, yeah. You're in the next question after this. Sorry.
So what are the next one is on going to be on plus...
So it's a hyperope, yeah. Hyperope plus
2.5. So you have a plus 2.5 diopter. CCT is 530, patient's age is 46, that's an important point, male. Yes, Ashish, sure. All yours.
Okay, thank you very much. I think the time started. Okay, so I think I have a tough one here. It's a hyperope and a 46-year-old. So I think as for hyperopes, we will be doing the routine, do the manifest refraction, do the cycloplegic, and even though he's 46, we'll try and see what is the maximum correction that he accepts. Because that is what we need to know for the final treatment. But here the problem is the presbyopia. I think that is what the case has been put up. How do we best treat? So there are many options, but we'll go for LASIK. While LASIK would be basically principally, we are trying to make the cornea steep, trying to make it a little more myopic so that the patient can see clearly for distance. And usually we try and combine these situations with a bit of monovision, as we also do for cataract surgeries. There are various ways in people combine. As you can see now, there's a traditional monovision, there's a mini monovision. So I think this is all gets combined based on the patient, per patient. It depends on the patient and the needs of the patient. So just to summarize, why not presbyopia LASIK? In principle, what presbyopia LASIK or the laser blended LASIK, as they call it, what it does is it induces a slight myopia in the non-dominant eye, and it also increases the spherical aberration. So as you can see, it creates a slightly blur zone, which can also be called as a blended zone because it works at the cortical level. And the corneal inlays, again, they work on one eye. You treat the non-dominant eye, it creates a pinhole. So again, it's trying to create a sort of a blur and recreate so that the at the cortical level, it can become increase the depth of focus. And a multifocal IOL is a good option, I would say, in such cases. But the drawback is that it's an intraocular surgery. And of course, we need to keep in mind the angle kappa, because despite the best of surgery, it might still create a very
Ashish, you're out of time, I think.
It's done? Okay. So to summarize, I would stick to, because with the hyperopic LASIK, nowadays with the newer ablations, with the flying spot lasers, the results are much better. And as we have seen, it creates something like a multifocal cornea. And we can definitely choose monovision, but we have to choose it very carefully with the patient. We can combine it with both the things. Thank you.
Thanks, Ashish. So next we have Dr. Sri Ganesh, who's going to speak on presbyopia LASIK. Here, I would like to just ask if Dr. Thind is here. I think he's not been able to make it. So he's the next speaker. Would anybody like to speak for a few seconds instead of Dr. Thind on corneal inlays? Would anybody like to take the case for corneal inlays? Just spontaneously?
It's dead.
Is anybody here doing corneal inlays for nobody at all? Nobody wants to do it. Okay. Okay. I think Kumar used to do it. Kumar, you were doing corneal inlays.
He did one.
He did one. And Dr. Grewal was doing corneal inlays. Yes. No? Great. Okay. So Ganesh, you can go.
Good afternoon, dear friends. So is there a debate at all? So the 46-year-old presbyopic patient, 2.5 hyperope, I would definitely say presbyon. Why not intraocular surgery? It's got serious risks like endophthalmitis, recurrent uveitis, CME, retinal detachment, even if it's 0.2%, if you are that one patient, you're done with. And other risks like PC rupture, PCO, loss of contrast, glare, halos, so no intraocular procedure. Why presbyon? It's got the highest patient satisfaction, good functional vision, easily adjustable, no permanent visual effects, no side effects, and even if it's something, then you can correct it with glasses. It's closely simulates nature. You have so many anisometric patients who never want glasses, good contrast sensitivity and stereopsis, and can maintain blended vision. Even if you do cataract surgery later on in life, it will not interfere with the surgery itself. Dear friends, there's a saying, the proof of the pudding is in eating, and what you have here is a living example. I thoroughly researched all the presbyopic procedures, and I chose presbyon. 2 years ago, I underwent this procedure during a live surgery.
Can we have that? Ganesh is a 47-year-old superlative eye surgeon.
I was a hyperope.
And the middle bit of green flashing light.
47-year-old.
Green flashing light's going to come nice and close and make her sharp. And your job is just to continuously look into the center of the flashing green cloud, just as you are, breathing gently as it
goes. This is immediate. So this is a living example. What more do you want? I've tasted the goods and I can certify that it works perfectly well. There's no other procedure for presbyopia. This is the best procedure. Thank you.
Wonderful, Ganesh. I just hope that you don't get ghosting. I was noticing the hinge much beyond, you know, being blocked by the sponge.
No, it's perfect. I can read your badge on your coat.
Great.
So he's one of the few
I was actually present for his live surgery, and right after live surgery, he came back to the audience, to the hall, and then I think he was part of the dinner.
Yeah, next day he operated also.
And he did live surgery next day.
So you are one of the few people who practice what they preach.
Great. So now we have Cyrus. We have Cyrus, who's going to talk on his preference for refractive lens exchange with a multifocal IOL.
Hi, everyone. See, the choice is very clear. So what's RELEX? Actually, RELEX was started about 16, 17 years ago. In fact, I was working with Packer and Fine in Eugene Eye Associates in Oregon. And that's when they were putting in the array for presbyopia. And presbyopic lens exchange, PRELEX, was first described in 1997. So this is an extension of cataract surgery, which is backed by 40 years of research. Why not monovision or LASIK? Since the patient is 46, 47 with an add of 1.5, at 50 is going to need LASIK again. You just have to wait. Besides the obvious loss of binocularity, I've observed that many monovision patients complain of a blur in the minus eye for distance, even though they may tolerate it. Presby LASIK is an abortive attempt to make a monofocal structure multifocal. It's the purposeful generation of aberrations and inducing of distortions, which refractive surgery is supposed to prevent in the first place. It came and went with other lovely inventions like conductive keratoplasty and scleral expansion bands. Corneal inlays, so we don't have to talk, it's a total flop and it's dead as the dodo. So RELEX is the best choice. It's bilateral cataract surgery backed by 40 years of modern cataract surgery technology and outcomes. You have pretty good distance and near vision. No corneal distortion, no extrusion, no loss of binocularity. And guess what, not like LASIK, no enhancements every 2 to 3 years. Thank you.
Thanks, Cyrus, for nicely doing that. So we have, before we do the audience poll, I think we will request Dr. Dhami, sir. You have been doing, Presby LASIK, sir, and would you like to, what would be your choice and what would be your comments? Can we give a mic to Dr. Dhami, please? Yes.
I have done, but I think the age is nearing cataract.
Sorry?
I have done presbyopic LASIK,
yes.
But this age,
Okay, sir, would like to do a multifocal IOX? Okay.
Dr. Ramamurthy, would you like
to come in?
He's a 46-year-old.
The chair should note that all the speakers, except me, were wearing presbyopic glasses. So they are not qualified to debate.
Dr. Chitra would like to chip in? Yeah. Dr. Kankaria, sir, what would be your choice for this patient?
But I'm not drowning, I'm swimming.
Plus 2.5. Can we give the mic to Dr. Kankaria, sir, please? And then Dr. Ramamurthy wants to say something.
Say, for my age, I am. For my age, or you want. For
46 year old, sir.
46 year. Presby LASIK, I find much better.
Which one, sir?
Presby LASIK.
Rajesh, you want to chip in with something? And then we'll go to Dr. Ramamurthy after that. Rajesh has something to say? Rajesh is right behind you. Yeah. He's behind you.
I still haven't reached presbyopia. Sorry.
Sorry?
No, but this patient had plus 2.5.
I've still not reached presbyopia, you know.
Great.
But I think most of the option, whether you choose a multifocal IOL, depending on the age of the patient, if this patient was slightly older, maybe in the 50s, maybe a presbyopic lens exchange would be better. But at 46, I think I can do a presby LASIK.
A hyperopic LASIK or presby LASIK?
Presby LASIK. Yeah.
Presby LASIK. Dr. Ramamurthy?
I think for every debate, you should have a NOTA option also.
That's what Namrata said, that would not like to do.
I would rather leave this patient alone. As he said, if it's past 50, maybe a RELEX would be quite all right. But Sri Ganesh is one of a kind in many ways.
But I'm wondering why you would leave this patient alone. If he has a plus 2.5, if you just do a hyperopic LASIK, he'll still get good near ability and good distance vision as well, because you'll have a hyperprolate cornea with a plus 2.5.
But the very reasons, why is it not, LASIK has been around for so long. But still, the number of people who are adapting to this, naysayers who point out the difficulties that others are facing. I think even in India, there are very few centers offering this. So though the capability does exist.
Yeah, okay. But I think that's the message that people has to take home.
Okay, so let's take an audience poll.
Hyperopes also do very well with LASIK.
Same here, I would do
this,
yes.
And they do benefit because they also get some amount of depth of focus.
Can we?
So even if you can just do one eye, little hyper correction, and you don't have software like PressBeyond, it can still
So work. I think we are going to run out of time. Let's quickly go to the poll. Can you put up the poll, please, and start the poll? Okay. So please don't wait. Vote for number 3. Vote for 1, 2, and 4. Yes. If you vote 3, then it will be counted as don't do anything. Yeah. Oh, so I think we have number 2, Presby LASIK. Ganesh, you managed to convince everyone, huh? Great. Okay, so he made his case quite well. Let's quickly go on to the next case. We have a myope, 2.5 diopters. Can the speakers take up? Dr. Namrata, our secretary, who's done an amazing job this year, can take the stage for the first case. So minus 2.5, sphere with minus 3.5 cylinder at 180 degrees, so it's with the rule astigmatism, and corneal thickness of 550. She is going to speak for femto LASIK. After that, Dr. Grewal will be speaking for SMILE and phakic lens with Dr. Kamal Kapoor. So let's go. Can you start the timer for 90 seconds, please?
So for me, it is an open and shut case. We would do a femtosecond LASIK in this. Minus 2.5 sphere, minus 3.5 cylinder. And it's a moderate myopia with astigmatism, and LASIK is currently the gold standard. And of course, it is more economical than ICL and SMILE. And with the current type of machines, there's absolutely no problem at all. And why not ICL? Because of numerous problems. Intraocular procedure, accuracy of the ICL, sizing, marking accuracy, post-op ICL rotation, etc. Then femtolasic has better predictability, has been shown in various papers, and in terms of the results, especially for moderate refractive cylinder. In terms of abrasions as well, for high myopia, the abrasions are said to be an issue when you compare it with ICL, but not for cases where you have moderate amount of refractive error. And optical and visual quality were comparable between ICL and LASIK in moderate myopes in one study, as has been shown. And it has a lot of problems which we all know about. Now, why not SMILE? Because as of now, FDA is not approved for treating astigmatism more than minus 0.5 diopters. And this IRIS registration is again an issue. And I'm sure cyclo rotation torsion adjustment is also an issue. Now, this paper which Srinik Ganesh says, everybody quotes, says clearly that tropolisic has similar results to SMILE. And has better results with good quality of vision and with improved contrast sensitivity and in all visual performance parameters when compared with the SMILE. And this is to summarize. I think I've talked about most of the things. I would go with femtosecond LASIK.
Thanks, Dr. Namrata. Can we have the next speaker? We are running behind time. Dr. Grewal, sir, and I'll request Kamal to please come over to the other podium. And for the next lot of speakers, I'll request them to please load their presentations as well. And in that lot, I'll request Dr. Fogler to speak first.
Yeah. Can I start?
Yes, sir. Please go ahead.
This patient may have an active profession, or he may be from army. And his number is only minus 2 with cylinder. I'll do SMILE in this case. These are the calculations. You have adequate tissue left. I'll take it to Callisto. Mark the X's of this patient under the microscope. This is the X's marking. And then in SMILE, I'll adjust the cone. This is how the cone is adjusted. I'll adjust the cone and get a very accurate correction for firing the laser in this case. This is the laser being fired. This is the dissection. The eye is not mentioned. If this is the right eye, I'll be going like this. And if this is the left eye, and that's it. In Excimer, you can never get uniform ablation. You get a pattern like this. Whereas SMILE gives you absolute uniform ablation. Good contrast, safety, high myopia, no dry eyes, no high order aberration, no DLK, no epithelial ingrowth, no exposure of the bed, a stable wavelength, no plumes, absolutely no periphery. The SMILE is the best for this case.
After that whirlwind presentation from Dr. Grewal, typical of his style, I'll request Kamal, can you start off?
The next group can have their presentation.
So Kamal is going to speak on phakic lens for this patient with high astigmatism.
Okay, I'll start. As I would say, no other parameters given, no age of the patient, no pregnancy, no other corneal topography given to me. So ancient wisdom says, do not sacrifice any tissue if it can be saved. So stop attacking the cornea again and again. this comparison will tell you, you are increasing, you're decreasing the optical zone, you're changing the contrast sensitivity of the patient. What about the pupil size? You have a huge astigmatism, you need a bigger ablation zone. What if the pupil size is large? You're stuck up again. What about the reversibility? Dependency on expensive equipment. We don't know what is a cornea. Is it too flat? Is it too steep? Is it scarred? There's a high astigmatism there. So in case I am colluded without this information and the only thing I know is a good anterior chamber depth, I'd go for a fake IC lens. What if the other eye has got a frosteo keratoconus? Would I go in for this? No, I would not. What if the patient has got a susceptibility for a dry eye? Would you do a corneal procedure? You quote 0.2% complications with a fake IC lens? Well, any surgical procedure has a complication. So it's just anecdotal quotes, doesn't matter. Blebs, conjunctival issues, surface disorders, altered biomechanics, very large pupil. Most of these patients may have some large pupil sizes. You can have large fake IC lenses customized made up to 8.5 millimeters. I've done that. LASIK complications, often flap related. But are these procedures reversible? They are not. Fake IC lenses is reversible. That is the biggest punchline. In case there is an issue, you always have a procedure to fall back upon. Corneal flap is permanent. Changes made in the cornea are permanent. DLK, corneal folds, all these issues are also noted and they are reported in the documents. DLK is ectasia.
Summarize, yeah.
So it's reversible. That is the punchline.
Thanks, Kamal.
Thank you.
Thank you, Kamal. So we have three very nice presentations. Dr. Namrata defending LASIK for this patient. And we'll go to the audience poll, I think, because we are running a little behind schedule. We can have maybe 1 minute of discussion, but then we have to go on to the next case. Can we have the audience poll? Okay, so we have choice one for femtolasic, Dr. Namrata. This patient with high astigmatism and myopia, smile, Dr. Grewal, and fake IC lens, Dr. Kamal. So can we start the poll, please? Okay, so we have 15 seconds. Okay, so I think Namrata wins this round. And I think everybody agrees. So anybody in the audience who would like to differ from this thing in the panel, would anybody like to differ from this? Okay, Ganesh, yes. And Rajesh, can you take the podium, please? Yeah.
Basically, the reason why people would not like to do it is because of the astigmatism and cyclotorsion. But like Dr. Grewal showed, you can mark it, and we have a paper on GRS also, which shows that with marking, the results are much better. And I have done pure cylinders up till four and a half diopters with excellent correction, and the stability is much better than femtolasic. So that's the point in favor of SMILE. The long-term stability for cylinder correction we find is better than femtolasic.
So I think Dr. Ritika's presentation. Who's going to? So Ritika is here. Can you give in your presentation? Okay. So actually, Dr. Fogla has to leave. So we are allowing him to present first. The rest of the order will remain the same, but the poll will carry the same order as it's on the slide. Sure. So Rajesh, we have now this situation where we are going to have a patient who is a myope, minus two diopter sphere, with minus 0.5 cylinder at 180, 25 years old female. Central corneal thickness 537 and a suspect cornea on topography. So there is a patient with not a very high refractive error, lady, 25 years old, good corneal thickness, but a cornea which is suspect. So Rajesh is going to speak on fake IC lens for this patient.
So when you say a suspect cornea, I think if you look at the axial map on top, that's what a suspect cornea would look like. And if you look at the patient's physical measurements, the K values are 40.4, 41.6, astigmatism about one diopter. And the corneal thickness is in the range of about 480, 490 microns. And I think often you will be, you know, tempted to go ahead and do this. So this patient, the patient's refraction was minus 2, minus 1, improving to 20/15. And this is a photograph taken from this case report of bilateral ectasia following SMILE. So this patient underwent SMILE, and you can see what happened in 6 months following the procedure. This is the patient who had PRK done, and 10 years later presented to the ophthalmologist, and this was the topography at that point of time. He was unaided 20/20. Another 7 years down the lane, you can see that the central cornea is beginning to show ectasia. The corneal thickness is still in the range of 511. Look at the cross-linking. If you look at 5 year follow-up, you can see that the K-max can flatten up to 2.5 diopters, and the astigmatism can also change by 1.79 diopters.
If you look at long-term outcomes of phakic IOL, as Kamal, the previous speaker, had already pointed out, you can see both with the conventional types or the central flow, the results are pretty good. So the advantages of phakic IOL are basically it leaves the cornea untouched. It provides a predictable refractive outcome. It's potentially a reversible procedure. And the possibility of an additional corneal procedure you can do as you follow up the patient in future. So I think instead of going ahead and immediately treating the patient where you don't know what's going to happen in future, it's better to maybe put a phakic IOL, follow up the patient, and if there is some progression or something, you can think about doing additional procedure.
Thanks, Rajesh. Thank you. And next, I think Rohit is going to speak next. Dr. Rohit is speaking on PRK extra. After that, Ritika, can you prepare your presentation there? Yeah. Sorry? Okay, you want to be the last? Okay. Okay, they want you to be the last? Okay. Okay. So, Dr. Rohit Shetty has done a lot of work on PRK extra, so he's going to try and defend PRK extra for this patient. We need his slides, please.
See, my talk is on PRK extra. What is the true picture? So, if you look at minus 2.5, we don't have the topography. We want to know, my talk is based on more of a mathematical, because the case is virtual, topography virtual, we don't know what it is. So we are worried about, will this case go into this, and how do we prevent this? So this is a small experiment about what happens when you just cut a flap, or when you just cut a smile lenticule, but don't take it out. We waited for 4 hours, and based on only these two things, we did this modeling, because most of what people talk today is on modeling. What when you say strength, because we don't have technologies to really prove what happens. So when you look at these results, we use this modeling, at interest of time, and not go into this. So what is interesting is your flap itself cuts down your biomechanics. If you're looking at, this is not the biomechanical parameter, this is in the KC mean and constant, this is more of a strength. It drops down drastically compared to a smile when it's lesser, but which keeps getting stronger because the healing is changing. Both the procedures cause biomechanical weakness. But when you really look at what happens to PRK, unfortunately we couldn't do that experiment after taking the epithelium off, with just the healing process, it is stronger because this is wound healing, water, etc. But you can see the change happening here. So PRK itself has more strength than these two, and these two, especially the LASIK, the entire burden is on the flap itself. This is my take on how to avoid a paranormal distribution.
Wonderful. Thanks, Rohit. We'll request Dr. Chitra. She's going to defend what she normally does, LASIK extra.
Good morning, friends and moderators here. Here, I am not here to feed you with boring scientific jargon. I have just 1 minute to talk to you, so I'm going to feed in logic to all these top class refractive surgeons who are sitting here. You have an awesome technology glaring at your face. You know that cross-linking is strengthening the cornea. You know it's going to address the ectasia, it's going to address the regression. So why the hell can't you treat this simple, silly situation of just a mere suspect cornea, take it up and widen the scope of laser vision correction? Dampen this unpredictability when you're not doing a cross-linking and make it a rock-hard, stable cornea. What am I going to show papers to you? There's so much of research which has come in that cross-linking in laser vision correction has come to stand. And we all know that whether it's a borderline topography, a high myopia, a hyperopia, or retreatment, cross-linking for laser vision correction is the only answer. The eyes are useless, friends, when the mind is blind. And opportunities you lose, someone else is going to take it on. And I believe progress is impossible without change. And those of you in this audience who cannot change their mind, believe me, you cannot change anything. It is only cross-linking with laser vision correction. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Chitra, for sticking to time and finishing before time, and very emphatic debate there. So we have Dr. Ritika Sajdev, who is going to defend smile extra for this situation.
I think I'll start by quoting one of our most glamorous and most proficient refractive surgeons who has the maximum experience in refractive surgery, Dr. Rupal. Smile is PRK without the pain and LASIK without the flap. And if you know anything about the millennials are a want it all generation. We always want the best of both worlds. And that is the perfect combination of smile extra. So I think Dr. Chitra has beautifully highlighted that the extra technology is a great tool when you are in a gray area as regards topography. SMILE does take a leap over the excimer because it gives you the femtosecond laser for correction, which is independent of various factors in the atmosphere, which can produce variable outcomes. The centration is on the visual axis, giving you a great optical outcome. It gives you a good zone. If this is a Vanai study done at Dr. Rupal Center, you see that the optical zone and the correction is much better with the SMILE versus the LASIK because of the peripheral loss of fluence that you have with the excimer laser, which you don't have in cases who are undergoing SMILE. The patient is postoperatively very comfortable with minimal dry eye. Biomechanically, as Dr. Rohit has highlighted, yes, SMILE may be a little less strong as PRK, but it is much stronger than LASIK, and we are already doing an extra procedure. So corneal biomechanics with SMILE with a superior visual quality than PRK, and no risk of haze or regression and not having to worry about epithelial remodeling is really where SMILE Extra steps up. In fact, this is a very recent article where SMILE has been done in patients with form thrust keratoconus, not just suspect topography which was diagnosed as form thrust keratoconus. And like the Athens protocol, it's coming out like the Aztec protocol. So I think SMILE is Extra is a great choice for this patient. Thank you.
Thanks, Ritika. So I think we have nicely debated all four things. So I'm left a little confused as to which one is going to win. But I think we'll go with the audience poll and then we'll have a short discussion. Dr. Rupal, you want to say something before that?
No.
Should we go with the poll, please? Yeah. And the next lot of speakers, if they've given their presentation, so your voting pads are already functional. Please vote. One for SMILE Extra, two for PRK Extra, three for LASIK Extra, and four for phakic lens. So there we get PRK Extra. All right, so that means surface takes the cake and then we have equal votes for number two and for SMILE Extra and phakic lens. So I think LASIK Extra is one thing which people don't want to make flap, I think. So I think a very fair thing. And Dr. Rupal, would you like to comment?
No, I wanted to ask, anybody has any other thought in mind about doing anything else for this particular patient instead of all these? Yeah.
Plain just PRK.
Would just plain C3R work? It's a low myopia, minus 2 with minus 0.5 diopter.
Rohit is saying, would you like to do pixel?
No, I'm just asking because. You would feel that PRK alone is also fine.
Can we have a mic in the audience, please? Can we give a mic? Rohit, can you,
If topography is what Dr. Rajesh showed, then it's extra will not work. We have to do the whole cross-linking. But if the topography is just a small deviation, then just a PRK.
We thought it just a suspect topography, so which means not
like
a frank FFKC.
Would you not like to wait and see if there are any changes that
of
are
course,
happening
if,
over a period
if
of
we
time?
If we follow that trend of, I mean, there was no time for this to discuss, but otherwise wait for a year if they're very young patient, don't do it.
Because then that would be the correct time to even do something. So if the patient comes at this stage, rather than taking a decision of any of these procedures, unless it's like really for any pressing reasons, it's better to wait and then choose your correct procedure.
Perfect. So I think nicely debated, and we can go on to our next situation. And for our next topic,
it's a 32 years old male, history of microkeratome, LASIK done 10 years back with minus 2 and minus 1.25 at 175 today with a central corneal thickness of 476 microns. What would you do?
So we have four speakers again. Dr. Ramamurthy is going to speak on surface enhancement, followed by who is speaking for Dr. Maipal? He said he won't be able to make it. Who is going to speak for Dr. Maipal's case, flap lift. I think Gitanjali or Ritika were supposed to take over. Okay, so I don't see them. We have for phakic lens, Dr. Kudlu is going to defend his case, and for a femto side cut with flap relift, Dr. Rupal Shah. Are we going to request Dr. Ramamurthy to take flap lift as well? I mean, for Dr. Maipal, no.
Sure, so give me 6 minutes.
Okay. Okay, go ahead. Yeah.
So enhancement, I think these are the most important parameters. 32-year-old, obviously my approach would be very different if it was 20, 21 years old. 10 years post-microkeratome LASIK, CCT of 476 microns, a significant power, but not a very high power, minus 2 with minus 1.25. So these being the criteria, these are the prerequisites I would like to satisfy myself with. Ensure it's regression and not iatrogenic keratectasia, because power can manifest. One of the first manifestations is residual power is iatrogenic keratectasia. PCVA should be 6x6. In this particular case, a good ocular surface and no topographic abnormalities. I think it's hardly debatable. A 6mm optic zone size would just consume about 45 microns. And my criteria is less than beyond 450 microns, you can go ahead and do a surface ablation. And I leave behind a residual surface bed of almost 430 microns and use a 0.02% mitomycin for a period of 1 minute. And it's not just our experience, but there's enough literature support to say that this works quite well. And obviously, the other, since you asked me to mention that also, the other tangible alternative would be to relieve the flap. The most important factor was that this procedure had been done 10 years earlier. If it had been residual power, it had been regression, which had been noticed a year and a half later, I would have gone ahead and relifted the flap and done this. But there is significant evidence to show that whenever the flap, the primary procedure has been done before 3 years, then the chance of epithelial ingrowth is quite high. And obviously, it becomes a difficult situation to deal with. So of course, the naysayers would be that pain and discomfort, but it's much less with the modern pain management with the use of ice cold saline, etc. Slower visual recovery, maybe the patient might take a month to settle down, but safety, ultimate results, what would matter. And haze, much less with mitomycin, and prolonged medication is a small price to pay. So I think it's a joke to argue about phakic intraoc lens and femtocat, because why take on a cannon to deal with an errant child? So basically the debate is between, as you rightly pointed out, between surface ablation and relifting the flap. And it's what is operative is the period which has elapsed. If it is a short period, I relifted the flap. But here, because it's 10 years and all criteria fulfilled, I think doing a surface ablation should suffice. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Ramamurthy. And I think next speaker, Dr. Krishna Prasad Kudlu, all the way from Udupi. He's going to speak on phakic lens for this situation.
Excuse me, can you put the time?
So patient is a 32-year-old male, history of microkeratome LASIK 10 years back, minus 2 with minus 1.25 cylinder at 175, corneal thickness 476.
Yeah, topography normal, but still I just want to show this one slide. After already one corneal procedure over, do you want to once again take risk with cornea? Whatever you say, whatever the study, but I personally feel that you can touch the cornea once, but after 10 years, I don't want to touch the cornea at all. Because we never know which patient develops ectasia. Anybody can say here, which patient will develop ectasia after the treatment. Nobody cannot prove that the ectasia will not happen. Ectasia will happen. And why you want to take risk with cornea, rather when we have got other options. For example, see, why we choose this phakic IOL? Because of the best post-operative visual acuity, contrast sensitivity, lesser induced higher order aberration, no night vision problem. Main thing, improved quality of vision. Just I'll show you a few of the study by Kimi et al. See, look at the comparison with wavefront guided LASIK. See, much ahead, vision ICL is always much ahead than all these things. When you compare with, even with the PRK, all patients are much, much better in vision toric ICL compared to with PRK or even with the LASIK. I think my bet is on second time winner after 10 years of residual refractive error. Money is not the problem. None of us, I think 500 plus ICL, I never had a endophthalmitis in my career. I think if you are having the option, if patient is only if you poor, I think you should, I deny that. Other than that, I think I would like to go ahead with ICL because of all these points, fewer induction, increased contrast sensitivity, improved night vision, less dry and faster visual recovery. Only thing is you have to do a good white to white. I think you are going to land with very good result. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Kudlu, for nicely making your point and avoid touching the cornea. Now we have none other than our judge here, the panelist, Dr. Rupal Shah, who's going to speak on, although she mostly does smile, but she's going to speak on femto side cut with flap relief for this patient.
Gaurav, I don't need 90 seconds. My previous speakers have covered it, that PRK is no good, flap relift is no good, and also, yeah, you said PRK is good, he showed all the haze and regression and pain. Flap relift, you yourself said, is not a good idea. And to have a procedure intraocularly and with no bother about how much it would cost, there are only few people who would really not be bothered, sir. Those people have done 10 years back a microkeratome LASIK. They've spent, say, maybe 25,000 for both eyes. And now you are talking about a procedure which is going to cost them three times the amount. And I don't know whether they're going to really agree to that. Also, I have to mention the same study as what Dr. Ramamurthy has shown, that there was a comparison, and it showed that out of all the causes for epithelial ingrowth, the cause for epithelial ingrowth which is standing out first is the flap relift. Also, there was a study which showed that clinically significant epithelial ingrowth occurred in none of the primary 3866 eyes done, but out of 15 of the 646 flap lift retreatment done, and clinically significant ingrowth was more frequent when flap lift retreatment was performed 3 or more years after primary LASIK, which is 7.7% versus 1.1%. And surface ablation, of course, leads to pain, delayed visual recovery, subepithelial Bowman's ridges, increased chances of haze. So I have something which can really work, and that is just to use your femtosecond laser to make a side cut alone and open the same plane as what you had before. Now, I know that most of us have OCT to guide us, and it will tell us what depth to go to. It will also tell us whether there is enough corneal tissue remaining behind, and therefore this is, to my mind, the safest and the best possible procedure to do a retreatment after 10 years. Thank you.
Thanks, Dr. Rupal. So I think we have the case for all the procedures, and we will, in spite of Dr. Mahipal not presenting flap lift, we will retain that as a choice for the audience to vote on. So can we have the audience vote? So we would have this patient, again, I would like to emphasize for the benefit of the audience, 32-year-old male, history of microkeratome LASIK 10 years back, minus 2 with 1.25 at 175, corneal thickness 476. And we have choice number A for surface enhancement, choice B for a flap lift, choice C for phakic lens, and choice 4 for femto side cut with flap relift and a laser ablation. So can we start the poll now, and you can go with A, B, C, and D. Okay, so we have a good number of votes for surface enhancement, Dr. Ramamurthy's, and we have fairly good number of votes for a femto side cut as well. And of course, I think Dr. Kudlu defended phakic lens very well, in spite of, I think he may, that may not be his procedure of choice, but I would like to also thank all the debaters to, you know, sportingly take up cases which they would sometimes not believe in, and there were many situations where I know that their choice of procedure would have been different. So I think for the benefit of the audience, definitely, surface or enhancement may be the choice of procedure, but then as we all know, in refractive surgery, there is no fixed way of looking at things, and for it can be a personal choice, and two choices may be right and three choices may be right too. So I think we come to our last case, and let's go ahead if the speakers have already loaded. Also, I'd like to remind the audience that before you leave the hall at the end of the last case, please remember to return the voting pads, because FDC people have been very kind to you know, lend us their voting pads from the quiz, and there's going to be a quiz in the evening where they will be used again. So we need to have the voting pads back. Can we have, for the next case, myope minus 22 with minus 2 cylinder in both eyes and an AC depth of 2.95. I don't see Dr. Sanjay Chaudhary here, so I think we'll go with the next speaker, Dr. Bharti. Dr. Sanjay Chaudhary was to speak on bioptics. Dr. Sudhang Bharti, sir, is going to speak on refractive lens exchange. So this is a myope, minus 22, with minus 2 cylinder in both eyes, and typically beyond the range of what is possible with a phakic lens as well, and AC depth, which is good for a phakic lens. Dr. Bharti is going to speak on refractive lens exchange.
So in the beginning, thanks Gaurav, and Sanjay knew that he is losing. So that is why he has not come. I have no financial interest. And clear lens extraction started in 1890. So it's such a old technology is still practiced, is again a proof that it is wonderful. This is the clear lens extraction video, very small video I think, but every one of us knows that there is not great deal in doing clear lens extraction. Just as you know, a IA will take care, you don't have to do phaco, and then after that you can put an IOL, a multifocal preferably. ICL is not available in 22 with two cylinder and causes cataract and glaucoma, and especially these are you know, regarding these intraocular surgical procedures for posterior chamber phakic IOL, visual performance of CLE is better than preoperative best corrected visual acuity, with only 51% patients getting good vision with ICL. They're much better, nearly 90% achieving that kind of vision. IOP showed a reduction as compared to any intraocular procedure where the IOP is increased after ICL. Also, endothelial cell density, there is no damage to endothelium after the clear lens extraction compared to ICL. Leaving alone is a choice. No notable complication in the clear lens extraction. Only complication which we see is posterior capsular opacification, which happened only in 14%, and there's a lot of other complications like lens opacities, glaucoma and ICL, pigment dispersion glaucoma, pupillary block glaucoma, rapidly progressing cataract, macular dot hemorrhage resolving but not reaching the 100% vision recovery. And
you'll have to summarize, sir, because the time is
and up. Also the target refraction in CLE is much better. So thank you very much.
Thanks, Dr. Bharti, sir. And then we have Dr. Kuresh, who's going to tell us not to touch this patient and leave the patient alone in spite of the patient requesting surgery.
You see, when your arguments are weak, you just keep on talking so that some people somewhere will get some point from this. It is an absurd thing. A patient who is normal, happy, seeing TV, attending all his or her things, and you simply want to subject every patient who walks into your clinic to some procedure. Most of patients with minus 22 will have some posterior segment pathologies. If they don't have it with your retinal surgeon, send him to two other retinal surgeons. Someone will find a hole somewhere. There are higher chances of retinal complications with a refractive lens exchange. Dr. Bharti conveniently has left out a host of papers which have shown this. Using the bioptics, working on cornea and lens gives you all possible complications of a lens procedure and corneal refractive procedures at enhanced cost. So luckily there was no speaker on this. They ran away. So my solution, Hippocrates said, physician do no harm. So leave alone. Do a good refraction, give good quality glasses. There is something called contact lenses which people forget. You know, you wear a contact lens, it sits right on the cornea. It's complication free if you teach the patient how to wear it. Till the patient is 65, he can wear it, get a cataract and get operated. Let him come to you with a visually significant cataract, he will beg you for surgery. Till then, you are trying to beg him for surgery for financial gains. So don't do this, do appropriate surgery at whenever you need. So no refractive lens exchange, just leave him or her alone. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Dr. Kuresh, sir. And we do have Dr. Sanjay Chaudhary to defend his case as well. So he's bringing a last moment surprise. This part, it's part of the strategy, I think. You know, he put the guard down for both Dr. Bharti and Dr. Kuresh. So Dr. Chaudhary, and
we
after
heard
that
you are sabotaging his practice. Here he's getting a chance to do two procedures and you are saying don't do anything at all, just put a contact lens in.
So while we wait, Dr. Dhami, what would be your choice?
Can I have a rebuttal?
Definitely, we'll give you a chance, sir. Chalo, theek. Yes. Customized ICL? Okay, yeah, that's a good choice. We didn't put that as a choice. Customized ICL. Or second choice, sir? What did he say?
Bioptics.
Bioptics?
Which Sanjay Chaudhary said.
Okay. So Dr. Sanjay has 90 seconds to defend his case. And I know that...
Sorry for barging in a little late rather than the other session. Okay, so you have a situation, 22 with two cylinder. What would you do? Look at this guy, 23 with two cylinder, and look at his presentation in life. We did an ICL in this patient. We were able to correct 18. This is what was residual. And from a vision of 6-12 with ICL in the right eye, he improved to 6-9 partial and in the left eye to 6-9. Then we did a service ablation with mitomycin for the balance. And this is the situation. The guy before and the guy now. What would your patient coming to you for help, what is he looking at you for? Here is a small understanding of what the patient is looking for. If you do a bioptic, then ICL does not add to the risk of RD, which clear lens extraction does. Surface ablation does not add to the risk of RD, which clear lens extraction does. Incidence of cataract, which some people may say, now with the ICL, with the central hole, is just 0.2%. And even if it happens 10 years down the line, in any case, it is something like doing a clear lens extraction. So why not give him a good quality of life now for the next 20 years? And disadvantage, clear lens extraction, 11% of these youngsters land up in a retinal detachment. And there is a loss of accommodation. Why traumatize this young individual? Leave alone, you have minification of the vision, you have a cosmetic blur on the face, and this leads to a loss of confidence. It could also result in poor matrimonial prospects for, like this patient here. He was really troubled by this, and such a patient is likely to go into depression.
You'll have to
thank finish, you
sir. Thank you, sir. Great. So we are just on time. It's the session is finishing. Thanks for talking, and we'll have an audience poll immediately because the next session has to start. So we have three choices presented: A for bioptics, B for refractive lens exchange, and C for best left alone. Let's have the poll. Yeah. Okay, so
last minute
entry by Dr. Chaudhary, and he's been able to convince everybody to go for bioptics. So with this, we come to a close for this session, and I would like to thank everybody in the audience and all our panelists, all our speakers who sat through the session today. Thanks, sir. So, and thanks to the audiovisual team for handling this so nicely for, you know, this rapid pace of the program. Thank you so much. And thanks, Dr. Rupa. Thank you.